Okay, so we are live. Hi, everybody. I'm Alexandru Mischie, cardiologist at Centre Hospitalier de Montluçon in France. I'm the head of the Tele-Cardiology Working Group, and I am so happy to present to you this great webinar, Tips and Tricks in TAVR, with exceptional guests, which we'll present, right away. I'm just reminding you that we have a wonderful telecardiology working group, which is part of the ISfTeH. The ISfTeH, the International Society for Telemedicine and eHealth, counts around 40,000 members. And please, you can come and join us whenever you want. You can visit our website. So for this webinar, I will be hosting the webinar with Mirvat Alasnag, from Saudi Arabia. Thank you so much, Mirvat, for taking the time and taking all your experience and connections to put this webinar on live. So I will give you the word. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you, Alexandru, for hosting this for us. This is one of a series of episodes that we've been running throughout the summer, Interventional Cardiology Working Group of the ISfTeH. This is on TAVR, and you know, without any further ado, I will hand over to the moderators of this session, Dr. Elshaby and Dr. Desai. I'm just very grateful to the faculty for agreeing and for having such a diverse and global faculty, you know, spanning from Asia to Europe to US. So welcome aboard, everybody. We'll be in the background, Alexandru and myself, and take it away, Dr. Elshaby and Dr. Desai.
Hello. Nice to have you all here, and thank you again to the faculty for agreeing to participate in this webinar. We have a very exciting program, and without wasting any more time, I'd like to invite our first speaker, Dr. Didier Tchetche from the Clinique Pasteur in Toulouse. He is a well-known and internationally recognized structural interventionalist who is going to speak to us today on the subject of coronary alignment and future coronary access, which is becoming more and more important as TAVR moves into a younger aged population. Dr. Didier.
Thank you very much, Khaled, for this very kind introduction. So it's a real pleasure for me to provide you with this quite short lecture, but just to simulate a discussion and provide the audience with some tips and tricks that may impact their daily practice for their patients. So let's talk about coronary alignment and future coronary access. Here are my disclosure. So first, if we start with coronary alignment, there is a kind of rationale for aiming at getting a proper commissural alignment of the THV with the anatomy of the patient. And the main reason is making sure that we enable coronary future coronary access, but there may be some considerations in terms of improving the flow within the sinus of Valsalva to make sure that we decrease these phenomenons of thrombotic events at the level of the leaflets, whether it be harm, halt, or true leaflet thrombosis, but also maybe, and Gilbert is going to drive us through that, enhance and make it possible to get a TAV in TAV in the future. So it's quite important to aim at a proper coronary alignment at the start. And based on the experience, gathered experience, we saw in the past quite high number of cases that there were some coronary disturbances, coronary occlusions, difficulty to get access to the coronary arteries. And one of these reasons, apart from the bulkiness of the leaflets, the length of surrounding leaflets from a failed varoprosthesis, for example, and an appropriate commissural alignment is one of the reasons for not being able to get access to the coronary artery. So we need to work on that. And Gilbert has driven this very important cornerstone study, the Align TAVR study, that studied the degree of misorientations of the commissural post of the transcatheter heart valves when we go on a regular practice without taking paying attention to the orientation of the delivery catheter. we can see that a severe misalignment is quite frequent and can reach up to 70% when we don't apply proper techniques. And if we apply proper techniques, we can decrease this rate rates below 10 to 30%. So it's very, very important to aim at that. So how do we achieve that? The first thing that we need to do, is to understand that CT scan assessment at baseline is really important to decide on the proper projection for a deployment of the THV. And if we aim at commissural alignment, we should be able to identify the commissure between the right and the left coronary sinus. And so we need to work on the cusp of the live view. And this is the way that we need to identify on the baseline CT scan to be able to achieve a proper commissural alignment, because it really varies from a patient to another one, from a tricuspid to a bicuspid patient and so on. So we need to work on that at baseline. Work in the cusp of a live view. So if we, the first device that was more thoroughly assessed in terms of being able to achieve commissural alignment, targeting a superimposition of the one of the commissure of the THV and the commissure of the native anatomy between the left and the right coronary sinus, was the Evolut platform. And with the Evolut platform, if we use as a landmark the flush port and we rotate it at 3 o'clock clockwise, and this is going to provide us with more ability, a higher likelihood to get a proper commissural alignment, that is to say, to put the CTAB in front of the commissure, the coronary commissure. So it's quite important to do that. The visually, at the level of the fluoroscopic marker, as you know that, we are looking at the heart marker. If we are in the cusp of a light projection, we're going to have a heart marker that is quite thick and large. And if we are in the free cusp view, we're going to get something that is quite flat. And so this is the kind of reference that we use. Keep the flush port at 3 o'clock. This is going to enhance your ability to get a proper commissural alignment with the Evolut platform. If we use the Port Echo device, we may apply the same technique, rotating 90 degrees clockwise. Depending on the flush port that you are looking at, if you watch the flush port of the stability layer, you're going to rotate it from 12 o'clock to 3 o'clock. If you are looking from the flush port of the handle itself, you're going to rotate it from 3 o'clock to something like 6 o'clock. But quite importantly, when you are on a fluoro, what you should really target is the aspect of the post, and one of the posts should be seen extremely flat, like a thin line, and this should be the post facing the commissure between the coronary sinuses. So it's very important to combine both maneuvers to be able to get a proper commissural alignment in the cusp of a lat view. For the accurate neo, it has been demonstrated that if you keep the flush port at 12 o'clock, you're going to get, for the vast majority of the patients, an adequate commissural alignment. But once again, once you are in fluoro, before starting deployment, you should aim at getting that aspect in the cusp of a live view, most of the time an aureo caudal projection, one of the posts being extremely flat, like a thin line. You can see those three dots facing the commissure between the right and the left coronary cusps. And so this is definitely the type of configuration that you should get when you deploy the device. So if we try to summarize the main tips and tricks for commissural alignment, the first one is really to try to work in the proper cusp of live view that fits the anatomy of the patient and allows you in a quite comfortable way to both deploy the device, control the handle if necessary, and see the screen. So sometimes it's a trade-off, but we should try to work in a cusp of a lab projection for, I would say, almost all devices in a contemporary practice. The first ports for the Evolut platform and the Portico platform or the Naviter should be rotated towards a 90 degrees clockwise rotation. It's more 12 o'clock orientation of the flush port for the accurate Neo and Neo 2 platforms. We sometimes have to fine tune to make additional movements at the level of the handle just to get a proper commissural alignment if we keep the posts as the landmarks or the heart marker. And it's all about combining push and pull movements and rotation of the handle, increasing the clockwise rotation that is applied to the handle, and you combine it with push-pull movements just to make sure that the torque coming from the handle is going to be distributed to the tip of the catheter. But this sometimes can be harmful for the patient. So the main advice is to do these adjustments in the ascending aorta or potentially in the thoracic descending aorta and avoid to achieve this type of fine tuning, to do this type of fine tuning within the anatomy of the patient, within the aorta, within the aortic valve. Sorry. So quite important at the end, if you want to keep the degree of tension that you have applied to the system, you need to relieve the tension on the level of the wire. This way, the rotation is going to keep be kept, and you're not going to see this unexpected rotations of the THV during the final release of the outflow portion. So release the tension on the guide wire. This is really important. I would say that the same rule applies for bicuspid aortic valves. These are the main rules for tricuspid valves. When we are dealing with what is the most frequently encountered type 1 left right bicuspid valves, we do the same thing. The idea is to align one of the posts of the THV with the raphe of the patient, the raphe that separates the left and the right cusps. And this way you're gonna maximize the chance to get a proper commissural alignment. So for type one left, right, the most frequently observed type of bicuspid, same rule applies. It's only when you have known type one left, right, for example, the type one that is going to connect the right and the non-coronary cusp, it may be a little bit more challenging because your intention of the coronary arteries may be different, and you need to align your technique, to modify your technique just to get to match what the CT scan tells you at baseline. So this is just an example. If you watch just the aspect of the heart marker of this patient, most of the time in a regular tricuspid patient, the heart marker, that aspect is going to be located more in the outer curvature of the aorta. Here we liberally rotated at the flush port close to 9 o'clock just to make sure that we could get a proper commissural alignment for our patients. So having said that, and keeping in mind that the main interest of getting a proper coronary alignment is to enable coronary access in the future, and this is going to be even of paramount importance when we are thinking about low risk and younger patients. So we need to understand how achievable is coronary access. Most of the experience relates derives from the very initial experiences, and we used to deploy the devices in various configurations. So we are now facing patients that are coming back for say, acute coronary syndromes, and we need to get need coronary cannulation. And you can see that it's not 100% success of coronary access, it's only for 94%. So they need to apply some tips and tricks to be able to get access to these coronary arteries. What is the best way to provide with tips and tricks? It's just through cases. So let's go through a couple of cases. The first case I wanted to share with you, highlight some key principles if you want to get access to the coronary artery. The first one is to make sure that you are in the central, you are centered, really centered in the center of the THV, just to be sure that you're not going to get access from the space between the aortic wall and the first struts of the THV. So make sure that you are central, use the wire, fall into the left ventricle, and then withdraw gently the guiding catheter. And by the usual rotation, you should be able to cannulate the coronary ostium. So start with a central position, and this is very, very important. So, and then it becomes a more standard procedure. I'm gonna go fast. These are regular cases. You all have a lot of experience with that. It was just to illustrate the fact that making sure that you're central at the start is going to maximize your chances to get a proper coronary access. Second case, a little bit more challenging, a patient with an acute coronary syndrome, so you need to get fast. And if you even by making sure that you're central, it still is difficult to get access through the struts, use a regular 0.035 wire or a Terumo hydrophilic wire just to get between the struts and the sinus of our SAVA wall, just to make sure that you find your way through the struts. So using a 0.035 wire, hydrophilic one, makes sense for particularly these I-frame self-expanding platforms. And something that is more utilized for potentially for TAVI, getting access to the coronary arteries for a TAVI platform, are guiding catheters extensions because they are softer and you may manipulate them, orientate them towards the coronary ostium. So if you are not selective, use a guide extension. It's going to help you get access and most importantly, complete the PCI for your patient. So quickly, the last case, it was a quite interesting case that we, from a patient that was treated 10 years ago with an Evolut platform with a high implant as we did in the past, a quite decent coronary, fortunate but adequate coronary alignment. And this patient presented himself with an acute coronary edema from an ischemic reason with some extremely calcified lesion from the left main and an occlusion of the obtuse marginal. So the main focus was the left main. So what we did was we could get access to the coronary artery, and we decided to go with a rotor burr. So despite the fact that the floppy rotor wire went through the struts, we weren't able to get across the stent struts. So what we did was to come back, use once again an hydrophilic wire, the Terumo wire that helped us get across the sinus, and then bring an extension, a microcatheter, and then complete the procedure in a more adequate way. And just getting through a different strut allowed us just to complete the procedure with the rotor burr in avoiding any interaction of this burr with the stent frame. So don't hesitate to change the location to work from one strut, one cell to the other one, because sometimes it's really helpful and you spare time for your patient. So just to summarize and to remain on time, just what are my tips and tricks for coronary access post TAVI? I would summarize by first, aortic root shot. If you don't know the patient, just to understand the anatomy, the effectiveness of the coronary, the commissural alignment for this particular patient. Use a pigtail or a wire to fall into the left ventricle to make sure that you are central, especially when the aorta is dilated. For the left coronary system, normal shapes, downsize, alpha size, just to make sure that you will be able to rotate the guiding catheters in that more constrained environment of the stent frame. These are not the native sinus of Valsalva, it's a smaller area. For the right coronary artery, usually the same shapes apply. You consider a non-selective wiring of the coronary artery. Microcatheter exchange makes sense, particularly the slippery microcatheters that we have now. And liberal use of guide catheter extension is also part of the procedure, because it really shortens the procedure timing. And when you are facing, for example, an acute coronary syndrome, it's very important not to lose time for your patient. And at last, if you have the ability to use steerable microcatheters or guide catheters, it could be also useful. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Didier. I think we're running a little over time regarding our host. Can we do the questions in between speakers, or should we keep the questions all till the end?
I think we're going to do a short discussion in between.
Okay, great. I just had a question, Didier. In the commissural alignment has been very extensively described for primarily the self-expanding transcatheter heart valves. It's much less predictable for the balloon expandable valves. Yet for many of us, including myself, I find that coronary access is easier usually after the implantation of a balloon expandable valve. Is that explained by the size of the stent frame, the length, the fact that the self-expanding valves usually have a bulkier frame that extends above the sinotubular junction? Is it related to the fact that the distance between the valve plane and the coronary ostium is shorter with a supra-annular valve than it is with an annular valve? I mean, how do you sort of explain that paradox?
So I think these are very important issues that you raised. And it's true that when you use a balloon expandable valve formed with a shorter stent frame, the likelihood to get access to the coronary arteries is higher. When you use a self-expanding, particularly a supra-annular self-expanding functioning platform, you may have some interaction of the pericardial tissue of the THV with the surrounding structure, with the anatomy of the patient. And this is going to make it more difficult for you. but in especially when you have a constrained portion, because the supraannular, for example, core valve is smaller at the level of the defects than at the level of the inflow portion. So we need to keep this into consideration, and that's why we need to work on that for that commercial alignment.
Thank you.
Do you feel that in intermediate lesions or ones where you think may be at risk, you know, in the future for intervention, if you're using a self-expanding platform, you're more likely to treat them up front?
So yeah, once again, a very contemporary concern, and this is this has to be done on a case by case basis. If you are, you think that even with a self-expanding platform, you are going to be able to get access to the coronary arteries in the future for your patient, you may leave the lesions as they are. If it's not the case, it's recommended to treat the lesion before, because it may be more difficult in the future.
Okay, I think in the interest of time, we'll keep moving on, but thank you. That was a fantastic presentation of a very difficult topic. Our next speaker today is a good friend of mine and co-trainee with me back in Toronto, Dr. Gilbert Tang. Gilbert is a cardiac surgeon who has almost entire structural practice these days, and is an expert in both TAVR and transcatheter mitral and tricuspid intervention. And he's going to be talking today about valve-in-valve, both surgical and TAVR.
All right, thanks very much for the invitation and the esteemed panelists here. So I'm going to keep my talk, like what Didier has shown, to be practical. We're not going to show much data because this is meant to be tips and tricks. So I'll start with TAV and SAF, and I'll talk about TAV and TAV because there's much less known about TAV and TAV. These are my disclosures. So this review, state-of-the-art review by Euro Intervention, is going to come out soon. It's just, we looked at the proof, and actually it's a pragmatic paper going over step-by-step about TAV and SAF specifically. And there are a number of factors that you should consider when you evaluate the patient. So first of all, the patient selection. What type of surgical valve failure? What's the mechanism of failure? What transcatheter valve dimensions you're going to be using? And are there any risk of coronary obstruction when you do TAV and SAF? And finally, what transcatheter valve are you going to use in terms of supraannular versus intraannular, in terms of risk of coronary access? And finally, any adjunctive techniques to help optimizing the outcomes. So just to first start with, well, does the valve, is the valve degenerated? So there are a number of criteria that we outline here that show that you want to distinguish the valve degeneration versus PPM or prosthesis patient mismatch. So in prosthesis patient mismatch, the valve function, particularly on TEE, would be normal. There's no leaflet abnormality. Also, the EOA typically will be a bit larger and it may even be normal. So even despite elevated gradient, if you see a normal valve structure, this valve is not degenerated, and likely because a too small a surgical valve was put in. So this patient, really a TAV and SAF option or TAVR option is not really ideal because you're really not going to expand the surgical valve frame. And there are other techniques to try to do that, but it might not help that much.
Dr. Tang, your slides don't seem to be advancing.
You may need to unshare and reshare if that's the case. I don't think the audience is able to see your slide. Okay.
Oh, I'm sorry. How about now?
It's coming out. Let's wait a second. Oh, okay. Yep. Try advancing now. Yeah, now it's working.
Okay, I apologize. So, let me just backtrack here. So this is the Euro Intervention paper that's coming out soon, talking about TAVR in SAF, so valve-in-valve TAVR in surgical valves. This is one of the figures showing some of the factors that might impact on the decision-making in terms of patient selection, pre-procedural planning, and procedure. We're talking more about prosthesis patient mismatch versus valve degeneration. You can see that in prosthesis patient mismatch, the valve is actually normal, but the surgical valve put in is too small for the patient. So even valve-in-valve TAVR may not help the patient because you're still constrained by the surgical valve. There are other techniques that can help expand that, but it does come with risks. I just want to show you this case example briefly, just to say that a 73-year-old obese female with a 19 millimeter trifecta, you can see that the STS growth were not high. Certainly, valve mount TAVR would be feasible, but given it's a 19 trifecta, and this is one of the valves that cannot be cracked or fractured, you wonder whether the patient is better off having surgery and maybe wood enlargement instead, rather than valve mount TAVR, because the valve itself, actually, we found out on the TE, was normal. This is some of the factors that we outlined that potentially favor TAVR and SAVR versus redo SAVR, and you can see some of the factors such as patient age or surgical risk, patient preference, the surgical valve size, whether there's any severe PPM present, and of course, the aortic root anatomy is still high risk of coronary obstruction, especially in the context of a lower surgical risk patient. This is a very popular app that you can download for free on Android or iPhone. It's called a Valve in Valve app developed by my friend and colleague, Dr. Vinny Bapat. And you can see that you can pick whichever surgical valves and even transcatheter valve. And based on the information, this anatomy, you'll be able to recommend a series of different transcatheter valve options and even recommend ideal implant depth. So I encourage you to look into that. This is coming from the app. You can see that different surgical valves have different fluoroscopic signatures. So when you do your CAF on these patients, it's very important and useful to look at what they look like on fluoroscopy. And one of the reasons for that is that different types of surgical valve, you can see these are all standard valves, but you can see depending on how it comes from. So this is a mosaic, which is a porcine leaflet. This is a Magna 3000, which is a pericardial valve, but mounted inside the frame. And this is a mitral flow 23 mounted outside the frame. All these valves are 23 millimeters. But if you look at the internal diameter, they are quite different because the way it's mounted. And so it's important to understand how these valves are mounted and what the true internal diameter is. That's how you select the valve, because that's where the transcatheter valve will sit. These are some of the workups checklists that we put in the supplement to show you what we need to look for when during the workups. I encourage you to read that at your own leisure. And people ask, well, how do you pick one valve versus the other? Well, this is kind of our recommendation. If you have a smaller surgical valve, maybe it's better to have a superannular self-expanding valve for optimizing hemodynamics. If you need coronary access, maybe a balloon expandable valve will be easier. If you have a stentless valve, either could be possible. You need to think about whether you can fracture the valve, be balloon valve fracture. If it's not feasible, maybe again, a self-expanding superannular valve will have better hemodynamics. There are some risks and benefits associated with fracturing before or after the TAVR procedure. These are some of the advantages and disadvantages you can read on your own leisure. I would say that fracturing after the implantation may risk a leaflet damage and migration of the valve, but it might allow better transcatheter valve expansion versus if you do it beforehand, it might be easier to implant the valve because the mismatch is a little bit less, but you could cause acute AI and hemodynamic decompensation. So how do you assess the coronary obstruction risk? You can see that this is a mosaic valve with three dots. What you do is you do in overlapping the two dots in the LAO projection. You can see that it's called a 1-2 semi-selected coronary angiography. And you can see that here in a video, you can see roughly where the surgical valve sits with the leaflet are. And you can, through that, determine the coronary obstruction risk. And you can see by drawing a virtual kind of valve, where would the valve expand into a cylinder? If you have lots of room here with the coronary catheter, you're likely to be fine. But if you can see this particular right side, you don't have a lot of room for the coronary catheter, the coronary obstruction risk of valve in valve TAVR would be higher. And in fact, the incidence is higher with valve in valve versus native valve. This is another slide looking at, well, what about the sinus sequestration? So if your top of your surgical valve is below the coronary, you likely would not have any problem doing valve-in-valve TAVR because you will not likely obstruct the coronary. The concern is when the surgical valve, the leaflet, goes above the coronary and you have a small sinuses, like on the right side here, that's when you can obstruct the coronary and you might have to use other adjunctive technique to protect the coronary, or maybe surgery is a better option. So Danny DeVere, and we came up with a classification. You can see this is a CT-based classification with fluoroscopic correlation, looking at different types of aortic root and where the surgical valve sits in the aortic root. And based on that, we come up with an algorithm to consider whether basilica would be useful in these situations. And again, I encourage you to read this paper at your own leisure. But I think what Didier mentioned already is that in terms of redo TAVR, you really want to ideally position your commissures right the first time with the first transcatheter valve, and I'll show you a few reasons why. And this is one of them. So you can see that if you have misalignment from this paper review that we put together, you can see that second transcatheter valve can obstruct the coronary. You can see the tall and commissural pulse here with the surgical valve. And if you face this one on coronary, it could make coronary access more difficult. And this is exactly why. You can see that on the top, even if you basilica the valve, on the left side, if you have good commissural alignment, you have good coronary flow. If you're on the right side, you have the commissural tap blocking that segment of the split leaflet. You haven't done anything good for the patient. You're still at risk of obstructing the coronary. So that's why important for the commissural alignment, even for the transcatheter valve in the TAV and SAV. And this case series from Japan outlining one of the techniques using a cutoff lap view to try to get the head marker, at least with the self-expanding valve facing you, so you can optimize the commissural alignment with TAVR and SAVR. And this paper coming out in from last sonograph group, again, using cutoff lap view to try to optimize the commissural alignment that Didier has already mentioned, and you can apply that potentially in TAVR in surgical valves as well. Let me shift here to TAVR and TAVR or redo TAVR. You can see there are a number of factors impacting the feasibility. One is the sinotubular junction width. You don't want to block off and create a seal off the root and obstruct the coronaries. The THV leaflet height is important in terms of do they expand above the sinotubular junction, such as supraannular valves. And of course, the implant depth of the initial valve. So if the implant a little bit too high, you might actually still block off the sinotubular junction. And that's something that we pay attention closely. You can see this is a paper that we published looking at angiographically with the balloon expandable valve. You can see that certain situation, if your valve is implant even at optimal depth, but if the frame and the leaflet extend above the sinotubular junction, you do not have enough room to clear, you will not be able to do a TAVR and redo TAVR in these situations. As you can, this is the similarly shown in the MedStar low risk of CT studies, looking at some of the frames, and you can see that about 13% of the patients not feasible for redo TAVR. And you can see this is a paper again, recently published, looking at the same concept. So if you have a supraannular valve on the left side and it extends above the narrow STJ, when you put a second valve in, you're gonna obstruct and cause sinus sequestration. Same thing for balloon expandable valve. If you have a sapien, in the aortic root and it goes above the STJ and is small, if you put a second sapien, you can still obstruct the coronary due to sinus sequestration, or even if you put an evolute, it makes no difference. And this paper recently showed that if you do an evolute and evolute, you can have up to 23% that have high coronary obstruction risk because the STJ will be completely sealed off, preventing any coronary flow. This is an editorial that we wrote in response to that. You can see that that's why we think that the alignment of the first valve matters in terms of certain root anatomy. If you put a shorter valve in and you put a second valve that's taller, you want to implant the second valve with commissural alignment so you can easily access the coronary. If you have a tall first transcatheter, you put in a second transcatheter valve, you ideally want to set yourself up first with a commissural alignment with the first valve, and such that if you have the second valve, you can still be able to maintain coronary access. And this is an editorial written by Giuseppe Tarantini looking at if you have a small STJ in a young patient and TAVR may not be feasible because coronary obstruction or coronary access will be an issue, maybe they should have surgery first because then you don't have any issue with coronary obstruction with a valve-in-valve TAVR later on and you'll be easy for coronary access. So let me show you a case that was presented in London Valve a couple of years ago. This patient had a 20 sapien 3, unfortunately developed a progressive PVL. And you can see that this patient have a very small aortic root, very calcified STJ, small sinuses. And so what we see, this was the initial sapien 3 deployment of a certain other institution. And you can see that progressively the PVL has worsened afterwards. And we look at the CT of the post-implant, you can see that despite nominal inflation, the valve was actually never fully expanded completely. You can see that it's slightly underexpanded. So what we were thinking about, well, you know, it's not degeneration per se, but with the PVL, so we'll post-dilate this valve and then put in maybe an evolute afterwards because of the hemodynamics. However, you can see the coronary is quite close to the valve frame and you have a calcified STJ, You can see that this is the initial aortogram, severe AVI from PVL with the valve. And you can see that we actually expanded with the two CCs with the commander system. The valve certainly expanded fluoroscopically, but there is still now some central AI because the 20S3 doesn't have a lot of coaptation reserve. So we now have created another problem. So what we decided is to first look at the coronary anatomy because we don't want to obstruct the coronary. And we actually protect it with a guide liner and with, and of course, actually, I didn't mention that this patient already had a left main stent in place. So it makes it a little more treacherous to protect the left main. We went ahead and deployed a 23 evolute. You can see with reasonable commercial alignment. We looked at the left main stent that was there. We worry about that it might be underexpanded. So we actually ballooned the stent, the left main stent, to improve the expansion and also push the native leaflet down from the previous post dilatation. This is the final result. You can see we've got pretty lucky, and you can see that the evolute frame, because the nitinol frame doesn't really fully expand against the sapien free frame here. And you can see the PVL is mild. We got a pretty good result in this patient. So now, what if you need to do some adjunctive technique like Pasteur? So if you have a transcatheter valve, what the off from the Adam Greenbaum and the NIH group suggests is you might need to balloon that split portion. You can see by doing so, expand and increase the space of the coronary flow before you implant a second transcatheter valve in there. And of course, like I said before, you still need to try to achieve commercial alignment to avoid the second transcatheter valve blocking this split portion and balloon portion of the split leaflet. Now, if you cannot redo TAVR, you're gonna have to explant the valve and do surgery. And this is a paper that my colleague Nimesh and I and others co-author, 42 centers looking at TAVR explant. You can see the mortality at 1 year is quite high, it's almost 30%. So this is certainly a very high risk operation. It's not the same as initial surgical aortic valve replacement. Now, if you don't want to take the transcatheter out, there are other options. And this very elegant case report from my colleague, Luigi Pirelli from Lenox Hill in New York, basically they leave the core valve frame intact actually in the root, and they just take out the leaflet so you don't have any issue with coronary obstruction and directly implant a sapien 3 inside. You can see with an open technique. And you can see this is a potential bailout technique if the patient's high surgical risk and you don't want to do a lot of work in the root that potentially need root replacement. So finally, I think this is a nice review article looking at, you know, how do you sequence these patients? Do you do surgery first and two TAVRs afterwards? Do you do TAVR first, then surgery, then TAVR again, or you do three TAVRs in a row? I would say that it's probably unlikely you can do three TAVRs in a row. I would say that maybe you can do a surgery, then TAVR, maybe a second TAVR in the future if you have a large surgical valve. But I think ultimately most patients, if they want to do TAVR first, they probably would have to expect to have surgery next so that you take everything out and then you can do a TAVR in a surgical valve in the future because you don't have to worry about coronary obstruction. So I think in summary, the TAVR itself is right now indicated in the United States for high surgical risk patients, but remember, in patients with severe prosthesis mismatch, you may not help these patients and they might be better off with surgery. You do need to have meticulous fluoro and CT panning, as I outlined before, looking at feasibility, especially coronary obstruction risk. I think Hall-style root anatomy for TAVR intact should consider SAVR as a first line option, particularly younger patients, given the durability of surgical valve, and you'll preserve your TAVR SAV option in the future. And you've seen that TAVR explant is riskier than first time TAVR. So really have to consider patients' lifetime management when the aortic valve disease. Well, I'd like to thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Gilbert. I think just in the interest of time, maybe we'll keep going with the presentations. Next up, we have Dr. Tiffany Chen. Tiffany, I have the privilege of working with her every day. She's our go-to imager on the transcatheter valve team. Just today we're doing a really complicated bicuspid valve, and you know, some of the pictures and workup that she did was instrumental in doing a TAVR in it. So I'll hand it over to Dr. Tiffany Chen.
Thank you, Nimesh. Thank you to the organizers for the opportunity to participate in this webinar. So the topic that I'll be presenting today on is imaging to predict TAVR outcomes. I probably would rather change this title to imaging to ensure optimal TAVR outcomes, and I'll share some sort of tips and tricks from an imaging standpoint. These are my disclosures. As we all know, the indications for TAVR are expanding into low risk, a younger population with more variable anatomy, particularly in the bicuspid population. And now there are, as Dr. Tang presented, increasing options for valve-in-valve TAVR. In addition, we have an increasing array of transcatheter valves available for use, which means that it makes it more complicated in order to make some decisions to really optimize outcomes. And here's where I think imaging does play an important role, although it is not the only factor. Clinical factors also are important as well. Just to provide an outline of the talk, we'll discuss annular assessment by imaging and how it allows us to first and foremost determine accurate sizing and help optimize selection of the valve. Secondarily, to use imaging to predict complications such as paravalvular leak, annular rupture, coronary obstruction, and heart block necessitating permanent pacing. We'll discuss some anatomic features that are specific to bicuspid valves and how they may impact TAVR outcome. And finally, I'll touch on some more advanced imaging techniques that may help us further refine TAVR in the future. So to start off with basics, as we know, the aortic annulus is defined as a virtual basal ring at the bottom of each cusp. And these days in contemporary practice, cardiac CT is standard for annular sizing for TAVR planning. The reason being that CT provides high spatial resolution and isotropic voxels that allow for multiplanar reconstruction. And using double oblique methods or now semi-automated softwares, we can fairly accurately determine the size of the aortic annulus, which is elliptical and dynamic and largest in systole. However, if CT for some reason is not available, there are alternative imaging techniques that can also help with a TAVR planning. And of course, a 3D TEE is one of those imaging modalities, obviates the need for iodinated contrast in patients who may have chronic kidney disease. It can be done intraprocedurally and follows very much the same principles as annular sizing by CT in the sense that we use a double oblique method to define that same virtual basal ring to determine the annular area perimeter. It may be more difficult, but we can also get coronary heights as well as dimensions of the sinuses of Valsalva and the sinotubular junction. How does TEE compare to CT for sizing? TEE measurements tend to be smaller, and there are, of course, disadvantages that we need to keep in mind, including much lower spatial resolution. It requires operator expertise, somebody who's perhaps trained in interventional echo. It's an invasive procedure for the patient and very importantly, cannot quantify calcification by echo. This is important for predicting potential complications with TAVR. So therefore CT still remains the gold standard for sizing and annular assessment. Another imaging modality that can be utilized other than CT is cardiac MRI. With cardiac MR, we are able to also get, size the annulus by using these 3D respiratory navigator sequences. These do not require gadolinium, although gadolinium is no longer, chronic kidney disease is no longer an absolute contraindication to the administration of gadolinium. And then with cardiac MR, of course, there's also a lot of additional information that may be clinically relevant in terms of procedural planning and evaluation of the patient for suitability of TAVR, including assessment of the LV size function, quantification of the AR with, if there is any, with phase contrast imaging and tissue characterization of the myocardium. You can also see the aortic valve morphology on SSFP cinnate sequences, which can allow us to see if the morphology is bicuspid or tricuspid. As I alluded to, there are several anatomic factors based on imaging that may influence the decision making in terms of choice of transcatheter valve for TAVR. One of the difficult situations is when we encounter borderline cases in terms of sizing, whether to go to under or oversize. These are just some of the potential complications with undersizing versus oversizing. That brings me up to this evaluation of the landing zone calcification. So other than sizing, one of the main purposes for the pre-procedural imaging is to assess calcification in the landing zone, that is at the annulus as well as the LVOT. This can be described in terms of nodularity, the extent based on circumferential extent or extent down into the LVOT, as well as the distribution or eccentricity of calcium. At this moment, we don't have very quantitative ways that are utilized, and the guidelines recommend a semi-quantitative grading scheme from mild, moderate, severe, incorporating all these features. And the clinical implications of landing zone calcium is that this can affect annular sizing in the sense that the borders may not be very very apparent whether to exclude or include annular calcium in the landing. So furthermore, complications such as PVL or annular rupture are related to the landing zone calcium, which I'll discuss. So the first complication discussed is paravalvular leak. Two of the main risk factors are relative undersizing, that is less oversizing, and that has been shown in the partner two intermediate risk cohort here. Then the second important factor is annular calcification, particularly in the upper LVOT, that is in that zone 2 millimeters below the aortic annulus. It's also been shown that distribution below the non-coronary cusp may promote paravalvular leak more readily. The eccentricity of the LVOT itself and may also play a role in mediating PVL. And this has been shown in a recent a study utilizing the SALT-TAVI data. So here is a case example of a patient who on the pre-procedural CT had very dense LVOT calcium extending more than 10 millimeters below the aortic annulus. It was very protuberant, located sort of between the left and non-coronary cusps. This patient had a 29 millimeter evolute probe placed and actually did develop moderate PVL posteriorly correlating to the region of where the calcification was. So ultimately this patient did get a percutaneous closure and did well. So moving on to another sort of dreaded complication with TAVR is annular rupture, and how do we, what do we look for on imaging? Again, it's related to LVOT calcification in the upper LVOT, again, below the non-coronary cusp. And there are some other clinical and procedural factors, including excessive oversizing and some patient-related factors that may cause annular rupture. Coronary obstruction, I won't spend too much time because Dr. Tang already covered it in great detail. This is more of a concern with valve-in-valve TAVR, also something that can happen with a sort of nave-in-valve TAVR. We'll skip over the valve-in-valve stuff, but in native TAVR, some of the features we look for in imaging would be the low coronary heights would predispose to a higher risk of coronary obstruction, particularly relative if the coronary height is shorter than the leaflet length, and especially in a patient with sort of effaced sinuses where the sinus diameter is less than 30 millimeters. And then an additional risk factor would be if the leaflets also appear to be heavily calcified and bulky with an effaced sinus. So here is a case example we had recently of a patient who had not very low, but low-ish right coronary artery and a very bulky, this is a MIP projection, a very bulky and calcified right coronary cusp also very kind of narrow sinuses that were on average about 25 millimeters. She underwent, had a 23 millimeter S3 placed did include the RCA that was treated with a snorkel stent. In terms of the need for permanent pacing, related to landing zone calcium, another additional anatomic risk factors is a short membranous septal length of less than 8 millimeters, which is this distance here. And this is in addition to the other sort of clinical factors that predispose to the need for pacing post-TAVR. Moving on to bicuspid valves. Some of the anatomic considerations that are specific to bicuspids are that the annulus may be more large and more elliptical, and there is variable raphe configuration, and this has certain implications into the outcome with TAVR. So rather than thinking in terms of the classic Sievers classification, it may make more sense to think in terms of a TAVR-based classification scheme based on the number of commissures, whether it's tricommissural or bicommissural, and whether there is a raphe present or not if the valve is bicommissural. Is there any data showing that this classification scheme does affect TAVR outcomes? In fact, there is. There was a recent study showing the configuration as well as calcification on the raphe and leaflet do in fact impact mortality as well as resulting in more than moderate degree of PVL. So what sort of imaging techniques may utilize in these bicuspid valves? Dr. Tchetche's group has described this phenomenon of potentially a higher rate of underexpansion in bicuspid valves therefore proposed using superannular sizing with the intercommissural distance at 4 millimeters above the annulus with the thought that that may represent where the landing zone could be in these bicuspid valves. This alternative superannular sizing technique may be more helpful in certain root configurations or geometries. For instance, if the patient has a sort of a tapered root where the higher superannular position is narrower than perhaps superannular sizing with ICD could be more useful than annular sizing. There's also some data that superannular sizing may be less reproducible compared to annular, to keep in mind, even in this cohort, that in 88% of cases that annular-based sizing was feasible. So there is some controversy there. And more recently, there's also other ways of superannular sizing in bicuspid valves that have been proposed, one of which is this LIRA method. Instead of taking an arbitrary 4 millimeters above the annular plane to determine the level of implantation of the raphe, which may be patient specific, and using that level to then do perimeter based sizing rather than a linear intercommissural distance. So this is an example where these three patients had similar intercommissural distance, but very different perimeters at this level. And the other scenario where interfacial distance may be difficult would be if at 4 millimeters above the aortic aneurysm in a functionally bicuspid, there is not a clear kind of two commissures at that level to get an ICD. So, and lastly, I just want to mention that there are advanced imaging techniques. These are some CT-based techniques in order to detect cardiac amyloid. It's common in some of the patients that are evaluated for TAVR. So the ability to calculate extracellular volume based on CT may be a gatekeeper to then further further work on including cardiac MRI or PYP scan. And with global longitudinal strain based on CT is possible and also has been shown to correlate with TAVR outcomes as well. In the future, there may be more work in terms of geometric modeling to try to predict some of the other outcomes, such as development of halt and structural valve degeneration. This was an abstract presented at ACC showing some preliminary data on some anatomic or geometric factors that contribute to the development of halt. And this is based on CT modeling. Maybe someday we'll have patient-specific predictive modeling incorporating multiple imaging parameters to further refine risk and optimize outcomes. With that, I'd like to close and thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Dr. Chen. We are running out of time. I'd like just to point out to the audience out there, a lot of the questions are being answered directly by the faculty. So if you look in your Q&A section, you'll be seeing a lot of your questions already being answered. We'll try and get to the questions that are still pending. But in the interest of time, I think we need to go ahead and move to our last speaker today. And it gives me great pleasure to introduce Dr. Nimesh Desai. He's a cardiac surgeon. He's the director of Thoracic Aortic Surgery Research Program in Pennsylvania State University. It gives me great pleasure. The topic is something I'm looking forward to, is we're moving into these lower risk patients, and sometimes patients that are substantially under the age cutoffs for by the guidelines demanding TAVI. How do we proceed, and how do we place a lifetime management plan for these patients that will cover their projected lifespan for 10, 15, possibly even 20 years when we're extending into patients in their late 50s, early 60s? How do we go about approaching the management plan in these patients?
Thank you. Thank you, appreciate the opportunity. I know we're a little bit over time, so I'll try to rush through a few things I think we're already really well covered. This is a great topic and one that can generate a ton of discussion, but as we think about how to deal with aortic stenosis for the lifetime of a patient, as a surgeon, I tend to see both sides of this equation. We tend to see a lot of younger patients with aortic valve disease as well. Our TAVR practice started off with patients who are in their mid-80s, now we're getting younger and younger patients. So these two groups of people that I see are coalescing, it's good to have sort of a strategy in terms of how to deal with all the different ramifications of decisions that we make, particularly in younger people that may have very significant impact on their future. We're going to really talk about people who we think have more than 10-year, but sometimes more than 20 or 30 or 40-year life expectancy, and how we manage these people over time. And one of the key things I think that has happened is, the TAVR trials and the TAVR world when we started were really focused on risk. You had to be too high risk for surgery or extreme risk or intermediate risk. And now that we know that TAVR can work pretty well in any cohort of risk and give you results in the short term, at least, that are similar to surgery or sometimes even better, that we need to think more about like life expectancy and age and really, what are the goals for the patient over the next 10, 15, 20, or maybe 50 years. If we look at the most recent AHA guidelines, they have a pretty sort of robust algorithm, but have really moved away from surgical risk into age-related questions and recommended that, you know, patients over under 65 have a surgical valve done. Patients between 65 and 80 have some kind of shared decision-making to choose between TAVR and SAVR. And those who are older typically will have a TAVR unless there's specific reasons why you would choose a surgical valve. There's a lot of things that go into that shared decision, and this is why it's a really hard shared decision, is, you know, there's age and life expectancy, which is primarily what we're going to talk about, valve anatomy, but then there's all these other things that can fall into here that can alter our decision-making. And so it's really not that straightforward sometimes. This is a paper from the looking only at surgical valve replacement by Joanne Trachtenberg, where they actually asked patients, like, did you understand, you know, tissue versus mechanical? Did you understand what, you know, what you were explained, and did you feel involved in the decision-making process? And, you know, a lot of patients didn't feel involved. Some patients, even after surgery, didn't know what kind of valve they had put in. You know, only a small proportion of patients actually really understood things like durability, clotting risk. So, you know, even just choosing between within surgical patients, mechanical versus tissue valves is pretty nuanced and complex. We do have pretty good longitudinal data from registries and from some randomized trials that show that patients under 50 or 55 generally have a better survival with mechanical valves versus tissue replacements, but that's really in the pre-TAVR era, so we don't know about the concept of valve in valve and in younger patients, although I think as we're learning more about it, we're still finding that biologic valves in really young patients probably is not a good long-term solution. One of the things that we really do have to be very cognizant of in the younger patient with a longer life expectancy is, as you get younger, it's less and less likely that you actually have a traditional three-leaflet valve. And we, Tiffany Chen went over some of the issues in bicuspid valves, but it is very common in the patients under 70 to not have a traditional three-leaflet degenerative stenosis, but to have some variant of a uni or bicuspid valve. Bicuspid valves are also very special in that they have aortopathy associated with them. And when I think about a bicuspid valve patient, which is the majority of our younger patients, you know, you're really thinking about a root and aortic valve complex. And we think about the causes of bicuspid valve, the neural crest origin of the leaflets and the ascending aorta together, that this is really a root disease, not just a valvular disease. And that's manifest in so many different ways, just how they calcify, the extreme like LVOT calcification you can see going along the aortomitral curtain, and sometimes even multiple layers of leaflet tissues and things like that when you operate on these patients surgically, that it is a more complex group of patients. 20 to 30% will develop a legitimate aneurysm that needs surgery. Over 80% will eventually have an aorta that's more than 4 centimeters. And the rate of aneurysm formation is 80 times the general population. So bicuspid patients, these younger patients really do have to have a consideration of not just their aortic valve, but their whole aortic root complex. And this was an editorial I wrote with Saif Anwaruddin, looking at sort of our decision-making of how to treat bicuspid valve stenosis in the context of TAVR. You know, the way that we broke this down and the way that I tend to think about these people is, let's think about their aorta first before we talk about risk, age, or anything else. If they have aortic problems, they probably need a more complicated operation to repair it. And if they don't have that and they're suitable for TAVR and they're kind of on the higher risk side, or they're older, or they don't have a long life expectancy, then TAVR is very reasonable. But, you know, a surgical valve replacement in a low-risk person that can kind of convert them from having a root problem to having a circular, a large aortic valve prosthesis in there that becomes a valve problem later is probably preferable. So, again, a lot of nuances here that we don't have time to go through, but, you know, always think of bicuspid patients in terms of their whole root. Well, also when I think about young patients, you know, we tend to think mechanical versus tissue replacements and valve in valves for the tissue valves later. But let's not forget, and I think there's been a ton of revitalized interest in the Ross operation. Inexperienced hands. We didn't do Rosses at our place for about 15 years, and now we've started them again and are doing, you know, a very large volume actually. And it's really related to these younger patients with who either have tissue valves in them already that are degenerated, or who have bicuspid or other complex congenital stenosis. And you know, there's no operation, there's no procedure you can do on a young patient with aortic valve stenosis that can return them to an almost normal life expectancy, except the Ross. So it was something to keep in mind, although obviously not everyone's a candidate for it. Here's a recent patient of mine who had aortic stenosis from a previous tissue valve that was put in when they were in their late teens, actually, or early 20s. We actually took that valve out that had degenerated within 5 or 6 years and put in and did a Ross and replaced the ascending aorta. And you know, have let, now this patient has sort of a normal functioning supported root reconstruction that hopefully will last their lifetime. Although we did initially come in requesting a valve-in-valve TAVR at the age of, I think it was 26 or 27. You know, that these are all things to think about over the long term, but these really young patients probably need something way more complicated than just a valve replacement typically. Gilbert already talked about some of the challenges of valve-in-valve and the importance when we think about the lifelong trajectory of the patient, how important it is to get a big valve in later for future valve-in-valve options if you're not going to do a Ross operation. We know that even in de novo aortic stenosis in the TAVR world, and we think TAVR valves are generally very non-obstructive, that we still see patient prosthesis mismatch that can impact mortality early on. We're part of in the lead center for the SMART trial, which is enrolling comparing self-expanding versus balloon expandable in these smaller annulus patients. So again, thinking about their lifetime, that actually putting a small valve in someone impacts their life expectancy and their future valve and valve options. For those patients who are going to surgery, we are very aggressive these days about insisting on putting in larger valves. So whether that means doing a root enlargement or a root replacement where you actually move the coronaries, I like using this Valsalva graft, move the coronaries out of the way. You can put a huge valve in there and you'll never have coronary obstruction later when you're doing a valve and valve TAVR. Also something that we're much more aggressive about these days, again, limited to experienced centers who do a lot of this work, but it's a very good option. And here's some of the problems that we're seeing with TAVR in young patients. And again, often they have other risk factors that I think are likely causes for early valve failure, but this is one of our original partner trial patients who actually had no paravalvular leak, you know, when we did their case originally with their sapien valve, but eventually developed this sort of large paravalvular leak and also had stenosis associated with it. And we actually went back in and put in a sapien 3, placed it lower, and got a good technical result in terms of the paravalvular leak, but we did leave them with a significant residual gradient. This patient really is inoperable due to their lungs. This is another patient in whom valve-in-valve symphony wasn't an option. This patient had a TAVR 3 years ago for this awful-looking porcelain aorta. At the time the TAVR was done, they had sequestered the sinuses on both sides. Essentially, there's literally no left coronary sinus at all. And our feeling was even if we tried to basilica this or something, we probably would still likely have left main coverage. So this is a patient who actually went back and did a circ-arrest operation, took out the porcelain aorta. But while I was in there, we put in a mechanical valve because we never ever want to go back in to deal with anything in this patient. So I think mechanical valves, you know, it feels like we really moved away from them, but in young patients, you know, it's still a very good lifelong option, especially those under 50. I think Gilbert already talked about the difficulties of taking out TAVR valves. And I personally don't think that a TAVR first in a young patient is the right solution. I think that if they're young, they can tolerate surgery. Surgical valves is the way to start. And then you can, a good surgical valve replacement can set up a very good TAVR later. There is a lot of innovation in the valve leaflet space that I assume will eventually get ported over to TAVR technology. This is the new Resilia technology that's in the Edwards surgical valves that is extremely resistant to calcification and at least at 5 years shows very good outcomes. And so, you know, when I think about patients and a lifelong strategy for dealing with aortic stenosis, I'd start by saying patients don't often understand the valve choices that are actually presented. With TAVR versus SAVR, I think the incision is an understandable thing, but the rest of it becomes very nuanced. And I think even as clinicians, we struggle with a lot of this stuff. For patients who are under 50, patients who can be repaired, we actually try to repair them. If we can do ROS, we do ROS, or place a very large tissue valve, 25, 27 or larger with good coronary clearance, or a mechanical valve. In that intermediate group patient, I still think surgery is probably preferable for most patients under 70, although the caveat is we really have to work hard to place a very large valve in those patients to really give them valve and valve options later. And for the 70 to 80 year olds, predominantly a TAVR first strategy, except in low risk bicuspids or patients in whom you think they're going to have a very long life expectancy and not great valve TAVR and TAVR options later. And just as an aortic surgeon who also does TAVR, you know, I just always plug out, always watch for concomitant aneurysm as well in these patients. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Nimesh. That was a fantastic talk. I think we are. We may have time for just maybe answering a couple of the questions that haven't been answered yet. Question to Dr. Chen on measuring the membranous septum length with CD to predict permanent pacemaker implantation. This is one from the audience out there, Dr. Chen.
Yeah, sure. I think that you know, it's important to keep in mind that's just one component of sort of the overall risk of pacing. I don't think many labs do it routinely. In fact, in the recent SCCT guidelines, it's, you know, it's not in there as part of the routine assessment, but there is some data for it. Again, it's also probably more of a gradation rather than a hard cutoff of 8 millimeters, but that's what the data show thus far.
Thank you very much. Any questions, Dr. Mirvat, that you may have from listening in on all this?
No, I actually don't. I was engaged with the Q&A, and I very appreciate the faculty who've been answering there. It's been a very engaging Q&A. And I think the most important is perhaps if they comment on the age cutoff has been an issue of contention, because the ACC has an age cutoff of 65 and the ESC has an age cutoff of 75. And many are saying, you know, age is a number, but, you know, a 75 can be more robust than a 65. We all know that. So I'm not sure why the guidelines even have an age factor there in determining what is the suitable approach for a patient with severe AS.
Yeah, I think the concept of life expectancy probably is more important, although hard to totally understand in many patients. Do you think that, you know, the differential guideline information is based on the data, or do we think there's also some financial concerns about TAVR, you know, in Europe, and that may be different in the United States? Gilbert, what are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, no, I think the U.S. guidelines were based on the PARTNER trial and the Evolut low-risk trial, which had a cutoff around 65. But unfortunately, as we all know, those trials, the mean age is almost 75, right? It was 74. And only a minority of patients are in that low age group. I mean, obviously, none of us were in those guidelines writing committees, so I'm not sure how they decide on giving class 1 indication for 65 to 80 for transgeneral TAVR. I'm not sure where that data actually comes from. And I think the European guidelines are a little bit more equipoise than 75. I mean, we're just answering one of the 10 Q&A from the attendees. I think we all know, and all the surgeons here, you know, Nimesh, that surgical valve excellent durability, you know, age 60 plus or 65 plus. You know, if you do a surgical aortic valve replacement, the chance of you needing a valve in TAVR probably at least will be 75 or even 80. So I think that will last your lifetime. But we don't know the durability of TAVR right now in age 65 or even 70. And even with 75 in the lowest trial, only have 2 years. We don't have any 5 years. So, you know, if they are not feasible for redo TAVR, then we have a problem, because let's, even if the future technologies improve, you may be able to get away with it, but if not, then they need to have surgery when they're in the 70s to 80s, and it's going to be a more complex operation, as the mesh is known.
Maybe a question I have also for the audience, which is maybe a little bit more relevant to our part of the world, and our patients tend to have smaller annuluses. So the most of the valves we implant in sapien valves would be, you know, 23 and 26, and the surgeons have the same problem. So we have patients that are smaller and have smaller annuluses. How does that figure into initially planning your procedures? You know, when you're talking about a 60, 65 year old, go TAVR first, or, you know, the advantage of a TAVR valve that has better hemodynamics, especially you implant a superannular valve in this patient. So would it be better to implant, you know, 26 core valve rather than taking him to surgery and implant a 23 surgical valve?
Yeah, I think it's a good question. With core valve, I always worry about the future valve-in-valve options a little bit, or the surgical explant, because, you know, they are difficult for sure. My own feeling is that the techniques for root enlargement, for instance, or root replacement that I showed in the presentation, I think people are becoming much more comfortable with them. That is, you know, fundamentally one of the important parts of this is, you know, SAVR is going to become, I mean, we're doing it in healthier and healthier people, which is great, but the technical elements of the operation we're doing should be harder, that we should be doing, you know, ROSs in young people, root replacements or root enlargements in you know, the middle-aged cohort, so that we actually are setting up everything properly for the TAV in SAV in the future.
I think there's a trial that's underway, the SMART trial, that's looking into small annuli actually with the different transcatheter heart valves. So hopefully that will give us a little more information. Didier, a question that is very practical. I know you've done quite a few bicuspids and you've been involved in the registry and so on. How many of the, you know, TAVRs that we're doing are quote unquote missed bicuspids? I mean, they're variable. Not all bicuspids are the same. Some of them are effectively tricuspids, or they behave like a tricuspid. So I just wonder how many were actually missed in all the main trials.
Yeah, it's true that it's sometimes difficult to differentiate what's so-called a functional bicuspid to a true bicuspid. So I tend to consider any kind of suspicion as a bicuspid anatomy. And we run a kind of, to make it short, a survey, a registry, 3 months registry, 6 centers. All the Alexandrians that entered the hospitals were screened with a CT scan, whether they had a medical treatment, a surgical treatment, or a TAVI. And in fact, bicuspid was identified by CT in the vast majority of the cases, and for the remainders, it was surgical. So it's it tells us that we should all combine CT scan with the T transthoracic echo for every single patient who is planned to receive a treatment of an aortic stenosis. So it should be part of the routine assessment.
Yeah, I think the, you know, this is, I learned this from Tiffany Chen, but the, you know, what she said once, I said, is this bicuspid or not? And she said, I need to see it open, right? That's the whole key, is it's not the still frame that it you can make those look like anything depending in some bicuspid anatomies, but watch the jet of blood go through it and you'll see it.
Thank you, everybody. It's been a fantastic session. I certainly enjoyed it. I hope you all enjoyed it. I hope our audience enjoyed it. So thank you, everybody, for participating. Thank you, Alexandra and Mirvat, for involving all of us. And I think we should sign off. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Arshebi. Thank you, Mirvat. Thank you, Dr. Tchetche. Thank you, Dr. Desai. Thank you, Dr. Chen. And thank you to our audience. I hope I didn't forget anything. Thank you, Dr. Tang, also. I hope to see you soon. And I really learned a lot. I hope we can do this again very soon. Thank you so much for your precious time, and have a nice evening.
Thank you.